All right, I need you to give me a big favor and give it up for your moderator. You may know him from Lucasfilm, Walt Disney World, or the New York Comic Con main stage. Our resident DeLorean time machine expert, Elliot Hansen!
How we doing? Woo! Are we ready to get this thing started?
Yeah!
Well, then I need you to get on your feet and make some noise for the one and only Michael J.
Well, gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us here tonight.
Hey,
yeah.
I don't have a mic. I said, I'm going to try. You didn't give me a radio mic because I'm afraid I'll beat myself in the head.
Well, welcome to New York.
Thank you.
You guys been having a good time so far?
Good to be here.
I like you.
So, when you come to New York, what's the first food you have to have when you get here?
I don't know.
I figured I'd start it easy with food.
Italian restaurant. It's called Salamiera or something like that. Above Columbus.
I saw that.
And 64th Street, across from Lincoln Center, kind of.
Cut, spring.
All right, thank you so much for coming, everybody. We'll see
you. I live in New York, so I have my, you know, hands with peace. But there's always places that neighborhood places are really great. There's a place near me called Vico, and I'm doing it. Vicolani. It's a great balsamic chicken.
Right. So we're going with Italian, so that's good to know. So, Chris, tell me about the first time that you guys met.
First time we guys met? Was it the first day of shooting?
Yeah, first day of shooting. You were out, I think, literally out in San Dorian. Said, here's Chris, this might go. Amazing. Yeah. He goes, I'm going to kill what? I'm like, what the hell is it? Crazy. And now my dining was around. It was really that crazy. I don't know many of you know, I'm telling tales out of school, but there was another actor who was playing Marty for 5 weeks, and then they brought me in last minute, threw me in some stuff. Said, like, weird stuff happened. Like, they wanted me to wear Converse, and I had. They said, what shoes do you want to wear? I said, these are good. And it started a whole revolution. I had a few free pair of shoes. Of course, my Air Nikes are worth $500,000 each. But it's been a cool ride. But he's been with me every step of the way, and he's just a genius man. He's the best part of doing this movie with me is working with Chris. And it remains to this day the best part of talking about this movie is to be with Chris.
Well, I recall it one night, we're shooting in the marketplace at night.
Yeah, the Twin Farmers Mall.
Yeah.
Twin Farmers Mall. You guys know more about it than we do.
And an announcement was made when we were shooting all night for two or three nights. And an announcement came up to everybody before we broke for lunch, which was like 1 o'clock in the morning, that we were all together at some spot, that there were announcements to be made.
They're hiding in a trailer.
And Spielberg was there, Bob Zemeckis, all the suits and shirts and
Kennedy
everything.
Marshall. Kennedy and Marshall.
No, I'm sorry. I'm a miss. I forget.
Yeah, no, I'll make it up.
Yeah. And the announcement at 1 o'clock in the morning after shooting for 6 weeks was that the actor playing Marty would no longer be playing Marty. And that tomorrow we would start shooting with Michael. And I didn't know Michael, other than hearing about him and 6 weeks of shooting, and they're going to change, And I felt that I barely made it through the 6 weeks things were. And now I was going to have to do it again. I just thought, how can I ever get that load again? You know what I mean? There was immediate chemistry, as they say.
Well, you were amazing. You did this, I was doing nothing. It was family time. And they came to me and said that there was this whole drama that I got, and I didn't know anything about. And they got to Gary Goldberg at family times 6 weeks ago, and asked if I could do the movie, and he didn't even tell me about it because I couldn't do it. And Meredith got pregnant, and that solved a lot of things. And so I always had this time. So Gary Goldberg said, you can do it, but you have to do family times in the daytime and Back to the Future at night. So I said, no problem. It's funny, now I'm going to risk trying because I had to tell the story. But my mother passed away 2 weeks ago. Oh. Yeah, I thought I was going to do it. But she said to me, and I called her, and I told her I was 23 years old. I called her up, and she was in Canada. I said, they brought me to this new Steven Spielberg movie, but I have to do it at night and do family ties at daytime. She said, absolutely not. I'm not doing it. I said, what? She said, me too tired. I said, Mom, I live through this kind of tired. It's going to be okay. But to this day, my mother thought, once to the stage, about 2 weeks ago. My mother thought that it was a bad idea for me to do Back to the Future. And she loved the movie, but she's so worried that I get tired. I get tired. but did you get back to the thing? So now I'm all of a sudden, I'm like, bam, from a Friday, Gary telling me about it. It's like the next week, 3 days later, I'm on a parking lot Pomona at 2 a.m. with this guy. You built a time machine out of the Lord. And I noticed two things. One thing was that it was a lot of fun to play this, and I could tell that they were starving for a goofball. They had a really brilliant method actor, doing really good work, but they needed an idiot, and they got me. And I could tell I was thrilling them with my idiocy. And my goofiness. And the other thing I noticed was Chris was a genius I'm sorry, you get a word in.
They did not come here to see me.
But Chris was genius at we call it acting and laying the pipe or doing the exposition. It's in every TV show you watch, they say, Brimby had the weapon and he brought it to the thing. And he goes, yeah, he had the weapon. It's all exposition because it's boring to get out. You have to get the information to tell the story. No actor wants to do exposition because it's boring. But this guy is the king of exposition. He's like, Mark, God, Brimby, you're going to go, and then there's a lot, And the freaking thing is, he can retain it all. Because he's so good at it, and he's so brilliantly entertaining. And I just went, well, not only am I, this is a cool thing that happened to me, but I gotta watch my ass, because this guy will pull me off the screen. And he did, literally in a bigger room.
This, the chemistry was there from the first scene we had. I was just, it was alive. And it was, it remained that way for three movies. Yeah. And that's a long, way, by the way. Yeah. Amazing.
Chris was funny even when he was not doing anything. Like he was funny just watching the past service, him picking out a hot dog eat. And one of my favorite moments was, it's no secret that Crispin Glover and Bob Zemeckis didn't get along on account of Chris being a little out there. Now, as an actor, I'm sure Chris would say the same thing. It's fun working with him because he's a genius. Amazing man. He can just go off on tangents, you know. Bring a broom and wave him with a broom. A sweep of indignation. Works for me. I find it very entertaining. But Bob had a hard time because these elaborately set up shots. And they literally had to build like pathways for Crispin to walk in. And so I walk out one time on my trailer, and Crispin and Bob are arguing outside of the trailers. And then Chris's trailer door opens. Chris is like tissing with the noises. I'm like, oh. The door goes back in, and he's a genius, that's the way to do it. Yeah, nope, not my thing on the door. I'm just screaming at him.
All right, so I reached out to some of the folks that I know, and they sent in some questions. And one of those persons is Kevin Pike, who helped build the DeLorean time machine. He was curious as to what each of you thought when you saw the DeLorean for the first time.
You said it for me.
Well, I don't know. I thought it looked right, you know. It looked like the kind of machine that did the things it did.
Three movies, man. From Back to the Future to Brokeback. I haven't seen you the other night, tell me a story. We haven't seen each other that much. I saw this thing the other night, I was in a hotel in Vancouver, and I had the TV on, and I fell asleep, and I clicked the clicker. My clicker, that's me, I'm 8 years old. My clicker, and this thing came on, I can only hear it, I couldn't see it. And it would sound like this, like, Doc is very drunk. He wanders into the street, and Biff shoots at him. And Marty, angry, went listening to him. And I realized it was the enhanced for visually handicapped people or whatever. Like, but it was described in the movie. I thought it was going insane. And then I was making up dollars from him. And Marty's still in that stupid pink suit. and it just goes through, but you were described very well. I feel goofy tonight. I don't know about you. I'm just having too much fun being nice to you.
Was that right?
Well, but wait. Chemistry, just keep the hand over there, we're doing fine.
So, Chris, you actually got your start here in New York on Broadway.
Yes. I started area kind of referred to as off. lifelong man.
Say clappers.
But, So, yes, but I understand what you're saying. It started here.
And speaking of Broadway, I understand that both of you have seen the musical that's currently playing in London. Did they do it right?
I don't see how they could have done it better.
That's great.
I mean, it's good.
I was supposed to go to England, and then the pandemic hit. I couldn't go, so they sent me a tape of it, like a big visual thing. Tape's the wrong word. The digital download. Got me an etching, a stone etching. But they sent me a thing, and it was fantastic. I thought they didn't fall into a trap, they could have fallen into it, just imitating us. They characters that were fully realized on their own, and I thought the play was really well written, the music was great, and I'm going to go when it comes to New York.
Well, I hear you might be able to do that next summer, so you'll have to come back to New York.
And I think we get free tickets. We're going to make a goddamn cent off the residence. So.
I hear they haven't cast the Marty and Doc yet, so, you know, there are auditions probably coming up.
Well, Marty, Doc, Chris just will play it. I can only play Doc. But it's a great show, and it's Bob Gale, who wrote with Back to the Future along with Bob Smith, put his whole heart and soul into it, and it's really great. Every time I see him, so I'm happy for him that this happened.
Wonderful. So I'm going to ask you a question now, Michael. Everyone, when they talk to you, uses the word optimist. How do you describe optimism?
Well, I have to point out that last year I've broken my cheek, my eye socket, my hand, my elbow, both humeruses, and my shoulder. So optimism is rocking for me. I had a rough year getting beat up. But that was really cool because it made me realize that the thing I wrote in my book that I like to plug my book, but I got four of them, so if you like one of them, fine. but I did this whole book about having all these tough things happen to me and how do I reconcile my optimism with that. And then I realized that with gratitude, optimism is sustainable. If you can find something to be grateful for. In anything, if you find something, you say, well, that's good. There's a wall, she's coming down on me, but this is good. And if you can do that, then life is an optimistic situation. Yeah. And you can just, it'll always get better. Yeah. 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 But I can say one thing about gratitude. When I first did the first Comic-Con I ever did, a fan show was in London, and I had this great experience, and I came back, and I did another one here, and I said, that I realized I did it so that I could, I did it for, like, I was doing it for you guys. I was doing it, like, to thank you for, and to be there for you. But what I learned was that it was you, again, that were giving to me, and you've given me my whole life. You guys have given me my whole life. Shows you my face on your ass, tattooed. I go, how good do they get? There's nothing to be grateful for or optimistic. But it's great. So yeah, I'm very optimistic. I think optimism is about thinking that things are more likely to get better than they get worse. And if you believe in that, you can be grateful for it. And if you're grateful for it, you'll sustain your optimism for the rest of your life.
Yeah. I love that. That's going to be my takeaway. Most likely to get better than get worse. That's going to be my takeaway from this weekend. So thank you.
Here is going back. Oh.
So Chris.
Yeah?
How did you get started on Taxi? How did that happen?
Oh, yeah.
Woo!
Yeah, the show you created in the 80s.
Taxi.
Taxi.
Taxi. So, what's it?
It's my southern accent.
How did I start on Taxi?
Yes. Yeah. How did you become a main cast member on Taxi?
I don't know. Well, it was a little bit ironic because I had an attitude when I moved to L.A. that I wasn't going to do sitcoms. It was not an unusual thing to encounter that attitude here in the city because real actors really do stuff that's worth doing. They don't do trite, like, sitcoms. So I
got over it, but thanks for the money.
Huh? Yeah. Boy, I tell you, no, never mind. But so when I went out to LA, I even told my new agent in LA that I didn't want to do sitcoms. So months went by, and when it was so while, he'd send me up for one and say, you should just, you know, just to meet the people. And then eventually I was set up for, to meet the people for Taxi. And I got all dressed up as
Jim.
as Jim.
You're looking at him like he was in Taxi.
That was Danny DeVito's.
It's coming through. It's there. It's still there. And so I got in my costume with a jacket with a peace emblem, like 60s wardrobe stuff. And I went, and when I was finished, they said, bring that to rehearsal. Where are we coming? So that's how that started.
Yeah. 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 But that film was amazing. I mean, I don't know if you've seen Once Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't want to do TV either. I don't want to do TV either, but starvation will make you like me. I was going up for this show, and they wanted Matthew Broderick, they didn't want me. And so Matthew Broderick had other things to do. So I went in and read one last time, and Gary hired me. And the network didn't want me. Then Brandon Tarkoff said, I can't picture his face in a lunchbox. So later on, we did the movie and stuff. And it was so successful, I sent him a lunchbox. But you were great, Taxi. Check it out. You should check out Taxi. Really good. But what was cool is Jim was people think, because Chris did the Chris thing, which he does as Chris, he's just that kind of like cool thinking and it all kind of all that happening as he goes along. He did that in Taxi. He did it back. Future Sim, similar character, but very different. Very different. And it's amazing that you created two wholly different human beings that are so nuts, but so great. And I mean, it's just so cool to know you. Yeah.
Chris, you should tell him how great he was on Family Ties.
Hell yeah, I mean, it's humble. That's right. Do Dennis Leary. You know Dennis Leary?
Yeah.
Dennis is a show rescue me. And it was a great show, and whatever. He never had any wars about anything. And I always give Dennis a hard time because he's always busting the bales and balls. But I said to him one day, I said, he asked me if I'd be in a show, and I said, you don't want me on your show. So I'll come on your show, and I'll win an Emmy, and the only Emmy that your show will win, And you would piss me, because the show was great, and he was in 7 million Emmys, so the fact that I had an Emmy and he didn't have one was so stupid. But it didn't make it any easier for him when I got one. and he, to this day, I walk in my office, I'm like, fuck it.
So you've both been on the sets of a couple movies.
Yes.
Have you taken anything from the set?
I don't do that. I have a shirt that I wore in Back to the Future 3. And it's got the little train, so it's kind of yellow.
Yeah!
And it resides pretty much unworn in my closet. My wife, Lisa, does not like to see it on me.
So what you're saying is everyone out there that has a certified shirt, that's not the shirt because it's in your closet.
No, it can't be. I have it.
At least it's so beautiful and so normal. And it's such a great person. I know how, like my wife, I don't know how they put up with this.
All right, so I'm going through all these questions everybody's sending me. It's amazing. People apparently want to ask y'all questions. So,
I don't know if I took anything from the set.
I suddenly have all these new Instagram followers. So, this is a good one. What is your favorite genre to act in? Sci-fi, romantic comedy, Western?
I don't know. I really don't care. whatever genre it's in, whether it's comedy, tragedy, tragic comedy, or whatever, if the role kind of turns me on, that's the reason to do it.
Yeah.
What you do transcends genre, though, because you play real human beings in whatever situation it is, unless you're not playing a human being, because you've done a few times play a few kind of robots and cartoons and stuff. But you're always believable, you're always great. You're always like someone said today in the line, said Buckaroo Banzai.
Buckaroo Banzai.
The coolest reference I've heard all day was Buckaroo Banzai is amazing. Roger Rabbit, all these great film roles. Yeah.
If you could listen to one song for the rest of your life, what would that one song be? If you could listen to one song.
One song.
Only one song, what would that
be? Why, we're getting personal. What would it be?
Try to be good. Power of love.
I'm pretty sure you've walked on.
I have a feeling that's not it. It's your
I don't know. There's a song, I don't remember who sings it, and I can't pick up the melody right here now, but it's a beautiful song. And it's a song that Lisa and I have picked to be our song. Aww. And that's that story.
Probably shouldn't tell her you don't remember the name of the song.
She's used to that.
I love the scream. What was the favorite scene in Back to the Future that you were in together?
What was not?
My favorite scene.
I mean, a scene that I kind of remember that Back to the Future 3, when they discover that Doc is doing his stuff in this barn, right?
Yeah.
And he's invented this enormous machine that creates ice. Yeah. And it's a scene that maybe opens on me doing something, and this, the ice machine is turned on, and steam comes out, and whistles blow, you know, the whole thing. And then the train comes, right?
Yes, popcorn.
And I think you're looking out the window at the train. Anyway, we do a long take. And then finally, in the midst of all this stuff, to have a train passing by in camera frame and the ice machine and all that, takes a lot of coordination and timing. And at the end of that scene, a little piece of ice comes out in a cup. And I had...
Baked to the future.
Yeah, and I had a line.
You had a line?
I had a line somewhere, a short line.
I never remember.
But for some reason, on a take, I couldn't remember the line.
What was hard about that was that like...
So the entire, everything I described to you had to be done all over again. About an hour later.
It was
not a fun moment.
You're not kidding. Long scenes, like trains would go by and horses would go by and people would like fall off and catch on fire and hang it from things. And then like here I would fade a line and that's it. The whole thing again. $50,000. Crazy. But at that point, it could fire us. My favorite scene to do with Chris was, and the whole thing, my favorite scene in the movie with Chris was actually a few scenes. Everything from when I showed up at his doorstep in 1955 through to when we were in the room and he had, he shares the crudity of this design. And they like this giant. Like the thing when the car goes through and hit the thing and it blows up. But that's when like I pulled the thing, man. I came here a time machine that you invented. And so, you know, like you did that whole riff about it. Who was the president? Who's vice president? Jerry Lewis? And I was just sitting there going, I'm the president of genius. I'm the president of like a brilliant guy who's going to go wherever he's going to go. And all I had to do was to just react. Just take it in and let it wash over me, and I would be brilliant. Because that was the whole thing, was just to be with Chris, just let him be Chris, and enjoy it. And as an actor, there's no better gift than to work with somebody who is that good. I mean, like, you can imagine, I'm a 23-year-old guy, we're going to the guy this freaking good. Like, really good. And it was thrilling. And then the rest of the movie was all the same. Anytime I had a chance to work with him, that was going to be a good day. I just had to work with Crispin, it was going to be fun, but weird. Any day I worked with Lee, I fell in love with her again. She was great, and such a great cast. Such a great, like, everybody, like Goldie, and like Clock Tower Lady, and everybody in that movie was really perfectly cast. Really great.
No, it really was that whole lightning in the bottle, like, it's, that's mainly why most of these people are here today, right? Just a show of hands. How many of you, it was the first thing you ever watched on a VHS?
Maybe.
Actually, I saw some VHS that I heard they're really valuable now.
It's the first family my family watched together was Back to the Future.
You never asked me about the stuff that I took from the movie.
That's actually what Bob Gale wanted to know.
Yeah, I didn't take anything, I was such a screw-up, so stupid. I should have bought the guitar.
Yeah.
I tried to buy the horse.
Yeah.
I couldn't buy the horse. The horse was really cool, because I was learning to ride. My wife is a great rider. We bought a farm in Vermont, we had like, the places to go to Vermont. Wow, man, Vermont. So I really wanted to have this horse. It was Whiskey, and the horse I rode the movie. And this horse was like a Porsche. I was doing it for you. And I said, I want this horse. They said, can I have a horse? I said, Monty, is entirely possible. And I get the horse. And I said, and I looked at him and I said, no, you can't get the horse. And I said, why? He said, because we can shoot a cannon off As his horse's head, he won't move. He won't. And I thought, that's true. They put so much time and effort into these movie horses. They exist to make movies. And they can do all these things that you wouldn't need them to do if you just went for a ride. And they can get on and off cars, they can jump over trains, they can do all this stuff because they're fearless. If I didn't get the horse, I didn't get the guitar. I got an old pair of Nike Cortezes. Were there?
Bruins.
Bruins, that's right. Bruins. The story behind that was I was wearing those shoes on one end. I'd just been hired, I was going in for costume. All this stuff really happened. They pulled out some clothes for me to wear. I said, that goofy vest thing looks cool. and they said, yeah, let's try it on. I said, it's so stupid, it looks like a life jacket. And Bob said, yeah, let's wear it. Write it down. And looking at something like that would be like, and they let me do it, like we were doing the scene with Leah, when she wakes up, and we did the scene a couple times, and I walked up to Bob and I said, I don't want to step on any toes, but you should have her, when I say, where are my pants? You should have her say, they're on my hope chest. And he said, yeah, that's great, we can do that. So that's my big point of pride, that I wrote that line.
So some people don't know, you actually learned to play guitar for the film.
Well, let me just bring up a short point. I learned to play guitar as a teenager, because it's what I did. I wanted to be a rock star. I didn't want to be like a TV star or a movie star. I didn't think it was possible. And I thought you'd get more chances on it. So I played guitar, and then when they asked me to do the movie, I said he's skateboarding, guitar playing, girl chasing. Idiot, and I was that was all me, and so I knew it was the right thing for me to do. But when I did the solo, then I'd be good. I finger synced it, like because they already recorded it, so I finger synced it, and then when I said to the editor, take advantage of that because anytime he cuts to me, I'll be playing the right notes, and he did, and I was really proud of that when I watched the movie. That I mean, I moved it from B flat to B because B flat's too weird, you know. And but that's what I did, and so I was so proud of that. And then I heard what's his name? This radio show, his podcast about movies. He's always really nice to me, and always says good things about my movies, which is really bad judgment on his part, but nice. But he said, like, the only bummer of my career was that guitar solo that I had to play in the notes. I felt like right now I'm saying, I love the notes you said, but this you're really wrong at. Oh, I lost my number. That was me playing there. At this great guitar teacher who taught. He said, I wanted an homage to all my favorite guitars. One has some pianos in it, some Jimi Hendrix, and Eddie Van Halen. We worked all that stuff into it, so I was really proud of that sequence. And the thing I felt bad about was the slight suggestion that I wrote Johnny B. Goode and Chuck Berry didn't. I think a lot of African Americans were pretty upset at me about that. And I suggested that a white kid had to invent the greatest song in the history of rock and roll. But I just did my best, and all credit to Chuck Berry.
Was there any performance that inspired both of you to become actors?
Well, when I was 12 years old, sorry.
I know, he gets the two lavalier mics and they give you the sick mic.
That was 3 years of my life.
To start over. When I was 12 years old, my mother was going to go see Hamlet, Laurence Olivier's Hamlet, and a movie, of course, and here in the city. And she didn't know whether to take me because she wasn't sure I was mature enough, old enough to understand what was happening. Because it's Shakespeare. And it was cut deep, you know. But she took me, and I was blown away. I went out, I got the record, the 78, what is it, 78?
Yeah.
Records at the time. And I kind of memorized speeches and just got into it. So that was kind of a performance and a theater piece that really hit home.
I don't know if people know this, but Chris is still a brilliant Shakespearean actor. He did King Lear 2 years ago in what was it? What's his name, Tim?
In the Berkshires.
Berkshires.
American Shakespeare Company.
Yeah, he had this big beard. I don't know if you saw a picture of him with this big ass David Letterman beard. But he's a fool. So keep saying that. I mean, I don't know if you're just Arnold or Chris, 3 hours, but to be with him, it makes me proud. And like, he's a great Shakespearean actor. He's a good Jim, God, Brown, is King Lear.
So, do this for Chris. I've had a lot of people ask me to get you to say great Scott, but we're going to do something different. I want you to deliver your favorite line from Shakespeare.
Don't do the Scottish play. Don't do the Scottish play.
Okay. Now is the winter of our discontent, made a glorious summer by this sun of yore.
One final thing that I want to talk about. I myself have donated many hours to the Fox Foundation.
Thank you.
How? It's on the floor now, you're not getting it back.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
I keep thinking you're losing your teeth.
Mine.
So how does that come to be? How does that get started? The Fox Foundation.
Oh, I'm going to finish. This is a story. If I can find this, I'll tell you the story. I was doing Family Ties, and I did Spin City, 70 years later. And I talked to Barbara Walters and People Magazine about the fact that I had Parkinson's. And like in the old days before the internet, that's how you get stuff out. You tweet, you told Barbara Walters. So and then it became this huge thing, and everybody knew about it. And which was my design, but I didn't know that they would act the way they did, would react the way they did, which was just total empathy, total curiosity, and then the zeal to help me and help people with Parkinson's. And I found that there's a whole community of people, like young people in my age, 30, 35, 40. I was having this old person's disease that was sitting on that chair and trying to get in the elevator before you, really slowing you down and pissing you off. And those people had Parkinson's, and it was their life, and it was now my life. I want to understand it more and I want to help. So I got involved with a few political organizations, found out how much money was available. And I realized that science was ahead of the money, that if we could pay for it, we could get research done that would help us. So I thought, well, I gotta do something. I'm doing a TV show. I had a great career in television, a great career in films. I was doing okay, and my family was not gonna starve, so I could dedicate my money and my efforts to find a cure. It was New Year's Eve going into 2000. I was in the Caribbean and I was swimming with Tracy. It was the end of the day, the kids were getting ready for New Year's Eve and we were taking one last swim of the year. And I went in the water and I was swimming and I saw this sea turtle. and the sea turtle, like, it had a chunk taken out of its beak and had a big thing that's flipped, but it was cool. Just chilling, just swimming through the water. And I started following it around, and I'm thinking, this is really, what am I learning from this? I'm learning something. And I'm learning, you get your ass kicked, but you keep going. And he was impressed me. So I got in the water, and I walked up to Tracy, and she handed me a towel. He said, what? I said, look at your face. I said, I'm leaving the show. I'm going to start the foundation. And that was this turtle. And I can't get it off. I have this turtle in here somewhere. I want a tattoo. And a tattoo of a turtle. Some of you wasted it on my face. but I spent mine on the turtle. And my wife was not too pleased. And she said, you get a sleeve, I know. And I said, it's one turtle, it's big. Now I want to get my dog, I want to get all kinds of stuff. But anyway, that's how the foundation started. So then I went to some people that I knew and said, I want to start this foundation, I don't know how to do it. And they said, well, think of a person like a business. So I personally like a business and said, like, I don't want to have a big endowment, I want to pile up money, ditch it out, I want to put money straight into research. And now 20 years later, we are the biggest part of the foundation in the world. We've raised over $1.5 billion. You guys all did it. You know, every one of you I know have helped in some way, whether you just cared about it, or you sent us money, or you got involved with some effort that people were doing at the bike-a-thon or whatever. I mean, it's just been amazing what's happened. And it's totally humbled me and totally made me realize that whatever else happened in my life, the best thing I had in my life was this thing. It's like Parkinson's is a gift. I've said to people it's a gift. And they brightly say you're nuts. And I say, yeah, it's a gift that keeps on taking. But it's a gift, and I wouldn't change it for anything. I mean, the fact that I'm in this position to help people, and they've helped me, and people like Chris have been there a lot for me. You've helped out a lot. How many of you have? And it's not about what I have. It's about what I've been given in terms of the voice to get this done and help people out. I mean, there are a million things. Cancer, all this stuff, we need to find answers to all of it. So if we go with what we know best, help there, and then help other people if they ask you to, or you get an opportunity to, that's what we're all here for, is help each other out.
So, final advice to everyone out there in the audience, like the one thing you're going to leave them with before we walk off stage, that little nugget of truth. No pressure. Got to use the microphone.
I have to quote, it was said once in a movie, the future is what you make it.
My favorite line in any movie, and there's nothing deep or valuable in it, it's just funny. And my favorite movie is Dr. Strangelove. And my favorite line of Dr. Strangelove is, you can't fight in here, this is a war room. That's why you can't fight in here, it's a war room, man. It's all nuts, so just suck in your breath and go ahead, carry on.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for spending some time with us at New York Comic Con. Please put your hands together for Christopher Lloyd. Thank you.
Yes, sir.